Thank you for joining us for CBN News Today. I'm Ephraim Graham. The Sochi Olympics are underway with some qualifying rounds starting before tonight's opening ceremonies. Today, a new security warning for international travelers headed to the Games. The Department of Homeland Security warns terrorists may try to use toothpaste tubes filled with explosives to create a bomb. CBN terrorism analyst Eric Stackelbeck has this report on other terror threats surrounding the Games.
You're looking at the so-called Ring of Steel, a massive security zone around the Sochi Olympics site, stretching for some 1,500 miles and fortified by up to 70,000 Russian soldiers and federal security agents. These Games are a huge stage for President Vladimir Putin to project Russia's strength to the world, and he has vowed to crack down hard on any potential threats. Sochi is located in Russia's North Caucasus region, only 300 miles from Islamic terrorist hotspots like Chechnya and Dagestan. Linked to Al-Qaeda, jihadists in these two areas want to break away from Mother Russia and form an Islamic emirate. They've carried out countless attacks against Russian interests over the past decade plus, and now they're threatening to strike the Olympics. In recent weeks, authorities in and around Sochi have been on the lookout for so-called black widows, female suicide bombers from Chechnya and Dagestan who have a deadly track record. The threats are clearly on the minds of Americans. A Pew Research poll showed that some 44% of Americans think that holding the Olympics in Sochi is a mistake. For now, though, some U.S. athletes don't seem too worried.
I know there have been a lot of concerns with security, but I'm not concerned. I think the organizing committee has done an amazing job of making sure everybody is safe. I personally feel very safe here.
One potential problem? With all the security focused around Sochi, some analysts have warned that terrorists could strike other Russian cities during the Games. Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
And terror threats are not the only concern in Sochi. Tourists and journalists are wondering if the city's hotels and infrastructure are ready for the huge crowds. And a two-time U.S. gold medalist is actually pulled out of one competition for fear of a poorly built course that could cause injury. Caitlin Burke reports.
The Sochi Winter Games are finally here, but unfortunately, they seem to have snuck up on Russia. Unfinished roads, dirty hotels, and toxic water met both athletes and reporters.
They have dozens and dozens of rooms not ready for journalists or whoever. It's just absolutely an embarrassment.
It's an Olympics off to a rocky start, and it's not just the city that's scrambling to make finishing touches. Officials are now adjusting one of the events after several athletes got hurt. It's the slope-style snowboarding course. Competition starts today, but in trial runs yesterday, at least three athletes were injured. One of them was two-time U.S. gold medalist Sean White. Now he says he won't compete in the event because the risk of injury isn't worth jeopardizing his other goals. Still, the biggest buzz in Sochi is about how unprepared the city is. This German tourist says she was rebooked twice because her hotel wasn't ready, and she says construction continues to be a problem.
The surroundings are not really nice because there really are a lot of construction sites.
In the athletes' village, conditions are a little better, but still not quite finished.
You can tell in the rooms there's just subtle details that would normally be finished.
Whether Sochi is ready or not, the Games begin today. Preliminary rounds of some sports are underway, and the opening ceremony is scheduled for tonight. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Back here in the U.S., the relentless and bitter winter is battering the Northeast with two major storms in 2 weeks and now a third on the way. Wednesday's storm delivered snow and lots of ice, making travel dangerous in more than 20 states, causing thousands of flight cancellations and even shutting down Michigan's I-94 due to a chain of collisions.
Today has been probably one of our worst days through this winter season.
Nearly 1 million people do not have power today, most of them in Pennsylvania. Crews are working as hard and as fast as they can before the next storm moves in, and it's coming this weekend. Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel is ordering his commanders to put greater emphasis on developing moral character in the armed forces. This comes after a rash of scandals across several branches of the military. This week, the Navy announced it is investigating allegations 30 senior sailors in its nuclear training program cheated on a qualification exam. Last month, the Air Force revealed more than 100 officers in the nation's nuclear missile corps have been implicated in a cheating scandal. The latest scandal? Hundreds of National Guard recruiters allegedly receive illegal recruiting bonuses, cheating the government out of $30 million. Hagel wants the service chiefs to dig deep and to find out if there is a widespread deficiency of character in the armed forces. Californians who signed up for Obamacare are having trouble finding doctors who can see them. Many report the list of available doctors are loaded with false information, and people who lost their previous insurance because of Obamacare are finding their doctors aren't covered by their new plans. The Los Angeles Times reports major insurers are trying to hold down the cost of premiums, but in order to do that, they've had to cut back on the number of doctors and hospitals available to new patients. It has gotten so bad the California Assembly has now intervened for residents who can't see their previous doctors. But their new measure only applies to pregnant women and to cancer patients. A new report from the Congressional Budget Office says Obamacare could cause millions of people to leave their jobs or reduce their working hours in the next 7 years. Now, the White House says this is actually good news, but Wednesday, lawmakers on Capitol Hill weighed in. Our John Waggy has more.
The nonpartisan CBO report estimates that the wording of the Obamacare law will force more than 2 million Americans either to leave the workforce or cut back on their hours.
The bad consequences are worse than anybody anticipated.
CBO Director Doug Elmendorf told the House Budget Committee Wednesday that the economic effects of Obamacare need more study, but that the program certainly is a factor in spending growth.
Yes, the expansion of Medicaid and the institution of subsidies, these tax credits to be provided through exchanges, is part of what's pushing up federal health care spending.
House Democrats claim the health law may actually do some short-term good for jobs and that the CBO report has been misrepresented.
As the media themselves have confessed, they bought hook, line, and sinker some of the talking points from our Republican colleagues. And unfortunately, misrepresentations go around the world three times before the truth begins to catch up. But maybe it will begin to catch up at this point.
But job loss is only one component of GOP concerns. The CBO report describes a tenfold increase in federal debt between 1974 and 2024.
Given these facts, what is driving, just so people are clear, what is driving the tenfold increase in the deficit?
Is growth in spending for Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid above all else, driven by both by the aging of the population, by an expansion of health insurance subsidies, and by rising costs of health care per person.
Meanwhile, the administration is airing happy songs as part of a sign-up ad campaign. The White House argued Tuesday that Obamacare will enable some people to spend more time with loved ones or to find more diverse job opportunities.
They're making a choice about their overall quality of life and perhaps pursuing something, either a new entrepreneurial opportunity or a new job, and they're choosing to spend more time with their family.
Both parties will continue to debate the latest report, but the fate of Obamacare will ultimately be decided by Americans whose health plans and their place in the workforce are quickly changing. John Waggy, CBN News.
More pregnant women in California are choosing to keep their babies. The state does not publish official abortion statistics, but a new study from the Guttmacher Institute reveals women are about half as likely to get an abortion than their peers 20 years ago in the state. Bailey Collier is one of the women behind the numbers. The young mother decided to keep her baby in the face of difficult circumstances.
I was scared for him and his health more than mine. Because he was really early, so I didn't know how that was really going to affect him. I'm not saying he's a mistake, but if I could have waited to have him, I would have waited, but now that I have him, I wouldn't take him back.
Abortion rates in the U.S. are at their lowest level since the Supreme Court legalized abortion back in 1973. A California law banning change therapy for patients seeking relief from same-sex attraction is now on hold. The law was scheduled to go into effect on January 1st, but the Liberty Council filed an appeal. Even though the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals upheld the law, Liberty asked for an injunction based on strong dissents from three judges. Now it's petitioning the Supreme Court to review the case. Liberty Council has filed two similar cases on change therapy in New Jersey, and it currently represents parents, their children, and two counseling associations dealing with same-sex attraction therapy. The European Union is working on a plan to let police stop cars by remote control. The London Telegraph reports it's part of a move for more surveillance and tracking measures by law enforcement authorities. The plan calls for all European cars to be fitted with a special device that would shut off gas to the engine and turn the ignition off, so police would be able to stop cars remotely from a control room. The plan is still in its early stages, but government watchdog groups are already speaking out against it. And one conservative member of the British Parliament warned such measures are leading to government by an unaccountable, secretive group. Imagine cars that can talk to each other, sending out warnings that could even prevent accidents. The new wave of the future may not be far-fetched. But as Caitlin Burke reports, it's a safety feature the U.S. government may soon require from automakers.
More than 30,000 people die every year on U.S. highways. But new technology could make the nation's roads much safer.
Early studies indicate that V2V has the potential to help drivers avoid 70 to 80% of vehicle crashes involving unimpaired drivers.
V2V stands for vehicle to vehicle, and it allows cars to transmit their speed, position, and other information. When it senses that a car is getting too close, it alerts the driver of the possible collision.
In Atlanta, AT&T recently opened its first drive studio, a production center testing the concept.
With vehicle-to-vehicle communications and speech enablement, a lot of those worries, a lot of those risks, a lot of those distractions will be minimized.
A government report on the costs and benefits of these connected cars is due out this month. But requiring automakers to install it in their cars is still years away. Regardless, officials call the new technology a game changer.
When these technologies are adopted across the fleet, the results could be nothing short of revolutionary for roadway safety. And when tied to vehicle-to-infrastructure technologies, not only will they deliver safety benefits, but they will be able to save fuel and increase mobility.
Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Still to come, Christians massacred. Now they're retaliating against the Muslims. Where this religious war is raging out of control and why the government has done nothing to stop it. French troops and African peacekeepers have come under fire in the capital of the Central African Republic. It's reportedly the heaviest fighting since French troops arrived last December. According to a local priest, heavy fighting between Muslims and Christians has left at least 75 people dead in a single town. Our Gary Lane has more.
Gunfire now erupts daily in the Central African Republic capital city of Bangui. This woman discovers that inching her way to shelter is dangerous. Getting caught in the crossfire could cost her life. 1,600 French soldiers and 5,000 African peacekeepers are here trying to reverse an escalation of bloodshed. After the Christian president was overthrown in a coup last March, Muslim militants known as the Salekas burned churches and carried out a number of massacres against Christians. Since the Muslim coup leader stepped down from the presidency, Christian militias known as the Anti-Balakas continue to take revenge on Muslims, killing them, looting, and destroying their homes and mosques. This Muslim man explains he's not part of the Salika militia. He's just fighting to defend his home and neighborhood, he says. Another Muslim man said he's ready to die for Islam. Because the civil war is not just politics, people are attacking Muslims and are against Islam. Hundreds of Muslims have fled to mosques, Christians to churches for protection. Interim President Samba Panza received an enthusiastic welcome from locals as she visited displaced people receiving refuge at a church compound. With no end in sight to the attacks and counterattacks, one reporter asks, what does the country need now? Security, she says. Gary Lane, CBN News.
Up next, actor Cuba Gooding Jr. talks about his latest role and will meet the man whose real-life story inspired the new film, Life of a King. Murder remains one of the leading causes of death for teenagers in America. That's why one man has spent more than 30 years trying to save lives. And he's doing it with a board game. His story is told in a new film starring Oscar winner Cuba Gooding Jr. I recently sat down with the star of Life of a King and the man who inspired the story. Washington, D.C., home to more than a half million people and at least a million stories. This one begins at a little white house, just 7 miles from 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
This is the story of a chess club founded for inner city youth. It's different from most, it's distinguished in boasts of not just teaching chess, but truth. It teaches young children to reason, to rationalize, to use good sense and intelligence against deception, treachery, and lies. So at the Big Chair Chess Club, we're on a mission to save the lives of our children, to teach the unteachable, reach the unreachable, and always think before you move.
Eugene Brown bought the old house in the early 90s.
Yours then, tell him I'm on my way.
Then traveled to the city's toughest neighborhoods, recruiting kids to learn chess and join his club.
I'm going into my third decade of teaching chess. And I can actually say that I think that I'm the one that brought chess east of the river in Washington, D.C.
Yet, this is more than just a game to the D.C. native. It's a lifesaver for the thousands who've sat down with him over the years.
Some of them never learn how to be real good chess players, but that's not our mission. Our mission is to get them to think before they move. You know, because of, I've seen too many kids make impulsive decisions that's ended up costing the rest of their life.
Impulsive decisions put Brown's son in jail for 16 years. His grandson is behind bars now. And despite his mother and father's love and hard work, Eugene did time too.
I must have did almost close to 20 years on layaway plans. A 7 year here, a 8 year here, a 6 month here.
We visited one of those stops where Eugene went after trying to hold up a bank for $3,200.
I went in Trenton State Prison in New Jersey in 1969. I was a young guy. I didn't know anyone in that prison.
Eugene Brown spent more than a dozen years locked up here at the New Jersey State Prison for that botched robbery attempt. They were among the toughest years of his life, but he still took solace in playing the game of chess.
That's how I did my time on a chessboard. I've seen the Muslims, I've seen the Christians, I've seen the stick-up guys, I've seen everybody had their cliques, and my clique was chess, you know, and that's what I carried around.
The big change came when another inmate taught Brown to apply the game to his life.
I said, man, I lost. I ain't know. He said, man, you never lose. He said, you're either learning lessons or you're teaching lessons. Chess is the only game that can't be won. It can only be played, just like life.
Three stages of life. Your opening, that's when you're a young fella. The middle game, that's when you like middle age. And the end game.
He's been sharing those lessons with children since his release. The work has earned chess awards, recognition from the city, and now his story moves to the big screen in Life of a King, starring Academy Award winner Cuba Gooding Jr.
Ah, yes, the pawns. They are the front line. They will be casualties.
Scraps born, man. Kids game.
It was really a wonderful experience to watch it the first time. And I think that's why I'm here talking about it like crazy.
Gooding compares this role to the noble characters he's played in films like Men of Honor, Red Tails, and Gifted Hands.
You are a man of faith and you make no bones about being a Christian.
That's right.
In Hollywood.
That's right.
One of the things we love about you.
You know, I'm surprised my pastor sees all my films. Because I ain't no commitment. Some of them movies ain't Christianly. Did you see Shadowboxing?
This film doesn't blatantly display faith, but surely you see it in the film.
No, it's God's will. It really is. And that's what's so cool about stuff like this, man. It's like, you know, I'm no saint in any way. And I make mistakes and I sin constantly. But it's my relationship I have. When you learn about people doing great things like this who have been incarcerated, it's easy to say, oh, he's a felon. He's an ex-con. But this is an ex-con who made a difference in the life of these kids who are now considered intellectuals, you know? And that connective tissue of society and life is what intrigues me. And I hope that, you know, people find healing in stories like this. King Perry it is. Now, King Perry has an army, and you're a part of it. But the problem is, you think you're out there doing the king's business, all you're really doing is sacrificing yourself. Like the pawn you truly are.
It ain't like that, B.
It's exactly like that, partner.
I didn't know I looked that good.
Brown loves the film, but says he can't take credit for this latest move in his endgame.
The only reason this movie was made, the only reason that I'm here is it's an ancestral blessing. You know, it's from my great-great-grandmother that probably prayed for us, my grandmother that prayed. I know my mother, you know. So this is all of those people that prayed, you know, for our family, for me.
And he thanks God for turning his tale of disgrace into a story of dignity.
Once you accept God, there's no limit to what you can do.
Eugene Brown is very inspiring. Life of a King is now available on DVD as well as digital download. And Eugene is in the process of finishing up a book, and that will be coming out soon. Stay with us. We're coming right back. And finally this hour, would you permanently give up the comforts of your home to dedicate your life to helping the homeless? Well, one man did just that. Tom McNamara is a retired teacher. He sold everything he owned to travel the country in his RV helping the homeless. During his time on the road, he's learned one thing that homeless people really need is socks.
Up here is roughly about 2,000 pairs of socks. I pull out a pair of socks and 90% of them will respond with one, a smile, or they'll go, "Oh my gosh, that's heavenly socks. Are you kidding me? You know, this is better than anything I could have gotten today."
Now, Tom has spent the last year and a half traveling and serving. He has been to 17 states and given away thousands of pairs of socks. Blessing to do that indeed. Well, that is going to do it for CBN News Today. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. Take the time to tell us what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can do that on Facebook or at CBN News on Twitter. Hope you join us again right here next time. Make it a great day, everybody.